We start with the thing which we just left before lunch, a source coupled VCO, and I said I can have either N channel all devices or the upper transistors could be P channel to make it CMOS. Let's say since these are two N channel devices, the basically if M5 and M6 are in saturation, these two voltage initially will be VDD minus VT. Is that correct? If they are in saturation, these are like a pass gates and you put VDD here, so they will give you one VT drop across the source drain and you will have VDD minus VT at both ends. If you have VDD minus VT, it should remain permanently. That is called metastable position. On the cliff, ball is sitting on the top, nothing happens. But if there is a noise, the ball may fall left or right from the cliff. Okay. This is called metastable to stable, bistable states. So anyone which may pick up noise little more than the other may bring this little higher than this or this little higher than this, and then M3, M4 have been connected in latch form. So one will start pulling it up, the other will start pulling it down. Is that point clear? Okay, so let's start with this definition. What will happen if you say now at some point of time when you start measuring that this M3 is not conducting, if we say that M3 is not conducting or M4 is conducting, obviously this potential should be such that if this is driven, this potential must be lower to switch it off. Is that point clear? I repeat, if M3 is to be turned off and M4 to be turned on, VGS minus, let's say initially when V1 must be equal to V2 when it starts, so this VGS must minus VT must be larger enough for M4 to conduct, and this should be less than VT not to conduct. So if that's so, this potential, let's say it is VGS minus VT, then this potential at least should be VGS minus 2 VT so that this transistor turns off. Okay. That is how you say the levels of out and out bar will be actually seen. Is that clear? If you say this is conducting, this potential to be switched off, this has to switch off, out must be something lower than this so that this conducts and this does not conduct. Okay. So if I plot this now, which this should be VDD minus 2 VT, this should be VDD minus VT. So this is conducting. VDS minus VDD minus VT is larger than VDD minus 2 VT. Okay. So this will be switched off because this is VDD minus 2 VT. This is VDD minus VT. So this turns on, this turns off. Okay. By one VT shift is at the edge, but we can say it switches off. V out is VDD minus 2 VT and V out bar is VDD minus VT. Edge off. It will switch off because this minus this and this minus this does not support, say, let's VT. Okay. So if that happens, I have a figure. You can draw that. I can keep this. You have the figure, I don't have, but I can keep like this. So I am interested to know these three potentials here, here and here, okay, V1, V2 and V out. V out bar is a bar of that, so that we can just say the otherwise. Okay, think of it, if this potential should be at least, and they are equal, if this device has to be switched off, it should be at least one VT below. Okay, so that is that 2 VT, minus 2 VT, I have removed that much voltage equivalently. Actually, one doesn't know at the start how it works, but that is how one thinks that noise would have actually done this kind of. In an oscillator, there is no input signal. So obviously, something must start in a way it can. Okay. So let us say initially, since we said M3 is off and M4 is on, so obviously one may say V out is VDD minus VTN5 minus VTN4 or at least 2 VTN. There is no current goes through M3, okay. Please look at your there. There is no current goes through M3. So M4 must provide you two IDS current so that one goes towards the M2 and the other M1 has to receive a current of
same IDS,
assuming M1 and M2 are identical. That means capacitor will be charged through what current? One IDS current. Is that correct? One IDS current, this capacitor will be charged. This is what I have shown. IDS4, it provides same current, and therefore, and there is no current coming from M3. Is that clear? M3 is switched off, no current is coming from M3. So if IDS2 and IDS1 were same as we did here, that means one IDS goes here, the other IDS must supply to charge this capacitance so that this potential and this potential are plus minus now. Is that clear? This potential and this potential are Vx, call it, say I have given the name V2, V1, this is V2, this is V1. So if you look at V2, let's say V2 was given by me, this is my V2, this is my V1. So what we see initially, let us say it was VDD minus VT, okay, and or actually it is, the top portion at this point, it is VDD minus 2 VT, that's why device was switched off. And as long as this remains, V2 remains VDD minus 2 VT, so that M3 remains switched off all the time and M4 conducts all the time. During this charge once occur, no changes will occur because capacitor will not then allow any current to flow further. At that instant, since V2 has gone to other higher this potential, and V1, please remember, we will not look into V1, we will see it is a complementary to that. V1 and V2 are complementary to each other. So we will right now not assume. You can see from here every cycle it just follows the V1. Okay. So when this occurs, the next stage, case 2, we'll see, we'll come back to see figure again. If M3 is on and M4 is off, let us say if M3 is on, so the inverse should occur. Is that clear? Now M3 should conduct and M4 should not conduct. Now it is the complementary case of V1, V2, and that's why I say V1, V2 will actually every clock cycle, they will switch over the, they will follow each other. The time taken for time to charge the capacitor, let us say, is delta T. So what is the current we have? IDS. So what is the charge dumped on the capacitor? IDS into T, delta T. However, what is the potential through which it is going through? VDD minus VTN and VDD minus 3 VTN, that is, it shifts through a voltage of 2 VTN. So the, what is the charge because of 2 VTN on the capacitor? C into 2 VTN. They must be same. So IDS delta T is C times 2 delta VTN, or delta T is 2 C VTN by IDS. Since the frequency is 2t delta t, repeats again, you can say it is IDS upon 4c BTN. So frequency of this multivibrator or this VCO, source coupled VCO, is decided by what? Is decided by IDS. IDS coming from where? Please look at it. IDS is decided by whom? V control. So I have now, I have voltage control I wanted, so I adjusted V control so that I decide my IDS. Capacitance I have put it, so this will give me the range, okay, what size range you are looking for. Threshold, of course, is the process technology which you are working at. Is that clear to you? So by adjusting the control voltage as well as the capacitance value, I can have a voltage control oscillator which gives me pulses at the output. Is that clear? Now the only thing why this, maybe it has advantage, we shall see little later. One of the advantage of this source coupled VCO is it is comparatively low power because it doesn't require huge power, depend of course see how much you want to charge. Typically it is having a relatively, compared to the other one which I'll discuss, is a low power circuit. But it has a very bad feature in the sense The other one which I am going to show you does not require external capacitor. It uses its own ring oscillator, uses its own capacitances. Is that clear to you? So because of this, now please remember, capacitance take firstly larger areas, and secondly it requires what kind of process? Either I'll have to create an MIM capacitor between two metal layers, or I should create a double poly process. This means I need additional process to have these kind of specialized capacitors made available to you. Let us say the thickness is very small for you, or thickness is larger for you, then you have one kind of capacitance and you want to change the capacitance. So you must have more than one capacitor in series or in parallel to adjust the desired value of C. So it requires little larger area to make the capacitance of your choice. Is that point clear? You have one unit area, you know this much. So you want larger or smaller, depends on you make 4 or 5 or 8. And parallel series, whatever combinations you do, you can adjust C value. And if you do so, you will you will use larger area of silicon for one capacitor. Okay. This is something problem. It requires technology, different technology, and it requires at times larger areas. Just even to reduce it, you will have to put in series of them. So it's not that it is a parallel every time. You can even series them and change the capacitance values. So all VCOs, source coupled VCOs as they are called, are good because comparatively to the other ring oscillator circuit, one finds that they are low power relatively, but requires new process, or rather different analog process, and also it requires area additionally. This is a weakness, the other is maybe some advantage. So if you are looking for relatively lower frequency circuits, okay, then you may have a problem, because then you have to actually put large C. If you have very large frequency, then your minimum C should be sufficient enough to go there. So there are issues which are not very easy to handle, so it limits your performance in most cases. But it's the easiest way of making a oscillator. This is therefore very popular in many circuits. If you see actual circuits in chips, you will find many have their used source coupled VCOs. The second one, which I said you, is called ring oscillator. Now it is also called current starved VCO. This M1, M2 essentially forms a mirror kind of input side. So, and that is controlled by V control. So if I have an M1, if I decide my V control, I decide the current in M1, and since it is mirrored on that, wherever I connect, the same current can be proportionately sized. If I use, I can pass in the other arms. You can see through this P channel, I am going on number of vertical inverters chains. Okay. Each column is an inverter chain, or rather one inverter plus additional something in between. 4 transistor inverter has been shown here. Okay. The method used here is, they decide the current, this decides the current. This is decided from M1, and M2 will decide the current in M6, M10, whatever that this side. Depending on the sizes, I can have different values. I may have same also. If I put same size correctly, then I can have this current and this current may be identical. But to show it right now, I am showing you as if this current is 6 and this current is 5, or rather 3, I should say, IDS 3. They are not same, but they may be, normally I will make it same. In between these two, this is an inverter sitting here. Okay. M5 and M4. Forms an inverter chain, inverter this. The output has a capacitance which is essentially the output capacitance of this inverter at this node plus the input capacitance of the next stage which it is driving. It's, you know, ring oscillator is inverter driving the next inverter. Okay. So obviously I know W into L is the area of our N channel and P channel. Into COX from the input side and from CDB, and this also are functions of areas. So one will be able to calculate the net capacitance, which will be area dependent for both omega n, n channel area and p channel areas. Okay. So this capacitance, which is self created, is that clear to you? It is self created. I don't put external capacitance here. I put natural capacitance which are available to me. Now the way it happens that I have a chain of such inverters, of course odd number, as I said, we already said odd is to be there to make it satisfy the Barkhausen criteria. And the last one, for example, is fed back here so that it forms the chain. Now why it is called starved is the following. The current here and current here, the way it will happen, depending on the output here, 1 or 0, either N channel will turn on or P channel will turn on. So if P channel turns on, this IDS6 will go through whatever current ID5 can take, only this much current it can push in. Your sizes may be decided by the RC time constant you are looking, but the currents are coming from current sources and current sinks. Is that clear to you? So it may be able to take larger currents, but it supplied lower current from the top for the case of this P channel. So it is called M5 is starved of current. It can drive larger currents, but it cannot, because the current is provided from, and why it has to be done? Because this current is controlled through the V control. So this is deciding how much current this arm can have. So this charges the capacitor, this, and the opposite, this capacitor discharges through M4, M3. This is like a normal inverter having a load of capacitor which charges through P channel and discharges through N channel. The only difference what is happening here is the currents in this are not just decided by W by F this, but also decided by the control voltage, which should be stronger than the capacitance effect coming from W bias of this. Is that clear to you? That is why this is called current starved VCO. If, of course, the oscillator frequency is IDS upon N is odd number. N is odd number. Please take it. I have not written it, but N is odd numbers. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. N is odd. C total. Whatever, please remember, what is C total? I repeat, the capacitance output of this and input of the next stage. That is the total capacitance at every node. Okay. Even here, this is the output, this is the input. So it is universally true. Now this, for the second year students or third year who may do some experiment, normally if you see in our lab, we put additional inverter here to monitor the frequency. Do you know why? If I don't do this, then this will start loading this. The last stage will have a different capacity. You have a probe, which probe has a much larger capacitance. So normally the last is a buffer stage through which you actually pick up the outputs in the lab. So please check it. There, if my sheet, old sheets are still running, I am told, 92 last analog lab I took, and I think I see the other day, the same experiments are still sitting there, which is a little odd for me. So is that clear? So this is another VCO, which is like a ring oscillator. Please remember, this is no different from ring oscillator. The only difference what we did, we added a control part on this. And by doing this, I can now make currents available for an inverter of my choice, which is proportional to control voltage.
IDS 4 and IDS 3 will be matched.
Generally, IDS 6 and 3 will be matched. Same size will keep. Generally, 90%.
The way it is shown, it is correct. This current and this current are same.
But
you can have a different duty cycles by adjusting different currents in the two arms. Charging current will be different, discharge current can be different. Okay, that is what a normal CMOS inverters, we keep it equal, but it need not be. I can have a duty cycle of 30%, 40%, maybe 50, which is equal. Okay. So I can always do whatever currents I push, I can always adjust its duty cycles.
Okay, so this is
also very popular in ring oscillator because it allows you to convert your normal ring oscillator into a VCO. Is that clear? Why it is becoming popular? Because ring oscillators we use very often. So, okay, here additional circuit if you do, it can convert itself into a voltage controlled. This is one class of oscillators we saw today. There are another class, and I keep saying you this answer I may give at the end, maybe, or you should think. There are circuits in which we only use RC networks, okay, or RC components to make oscillations. Most of the feedback circuit we looked earlier have only R and C. But there are another class of circuits which requires LC combinations instead of RCs. So firstly, think of it, why LC can do what RC cannot, and if initially if RCs were doing, why LCs were not used then? Okay, either way, at certain bandwidths or frequencies we always use RCs, and at much higher frequency prefer to go for LC circuits. So why complementary to each other was not tried, abhi thode baad mein, let's think of it. This is an issue which is not very true every time, but yes, there are issues where RCs have advantage, sometimes LCs have advantage. So we look into second class of oscillators, which are essentially called LC oscillators, inductance capacitance. Their basic principle lies in the, is called tank circuit. An inductor in parallel to capacitance. Let us say both inductors and capacitors are idle. In fact, actually capacitors also are leaky to some extent. So in real life, if the capacitance are used, have different dielectrics, its tan delta has to be figured out, and the resistive part even there can occur, though 99% we never show that. You have seen inductance we show, but capacitance in real life, even C can actually create additional resistance there. But okay. In ideal case, if I see this circuit, if I monitor the capacitance on this side at a frequency which I call it F is equal to 1 upon 2 pi root LC, which is called the resonant frequency of this tank circuit, it is called resonant tank circuit. Now if we find at this frequency, if I monitor Z, what is the impedance do you expect this to happen? How much at this frequency when it resonates? Current zero hai. Infinite. Okay. Impedance is infinite. Okay. What essentially I am saying that the j omega L at this frequency is equal to opposite 1 upon j omega C for this. They are equal and opposite. Is that correct? And because of that, the current in this arm is 0, and therefore the impedance seen is infinite. But any other frequency, they may not be equal, and therefore there will be a decrease in Z as you move away from resonant frequency. Now this fact is very interesting, that infinite, whenever a tank occurs, it gives you infinite Z. Okay. This can be understood very easily. The problem starts like this. If let us say capacitor is charged and there is no dissipation, so it discharges through the inductor, L di by dt, this. Since inductor stores energy, that energy is discharged through a capacitor, and it will keep happening n times. So you will get oscillations, charge, discharge, charge, discharge. Okay. But that is essentially saying that there is no dissipation. So in real life, there is no such thing like ideal tank circuit, okay, or ideal resonant circuit. Inductance being always metallic wire, it always has some small series resistance associated. Is that clear to you? And as soon as now you say R is there, some IR drop will keep coming. So one time VC may be full, but next time it will go down, okay, because that is heated out, heat out. So you will not have infinite impedance essentially equivalently saying it will be some finite impedance. And the name which essentially says dissipation factor is called Q, okay, the Q of the tank circuit, which is essentially given by omega L by R, okay. That means there is a finite Q. In normal case, ideally what Q should have been infinite, okay. In most CMOS or NMOS technologies, the Q which will get maybe 3 to 4 or 5, okay. Our attempt to get higher Qs actually have much more trouble some other day in designs, okay. So since the typical inductance are made out of wires or metal lines printed on the silicon substrate or rather silicon dioxide areas, it is something like a spiral we create. Okay, you can have. This is how inductance are printed. Okay. The gap, the turns, they decide net inductance of this spiral which we create. Why we do not create circular, that is ideal, but circular, this on a graphic terminal is very difficult, okay. So easiest is Cartesian XY, okay. So all spirals are normally XY spirals, but they could be circular by some tricks, but it requires better graphic and longer time to do this, which does not help you great anyway in some sense. So if you now say it has some finite resistance, so let us see what is the Z now available to you. Because you say this, now Z will be different from the infinite value which we created at that frequency. So I calculated Rs plus L1s upon 1 plus L1C1s square plus Rsc1. J omega L and Rs are in series and parallel is the capacitor. Okay. So if I do this, this is what essentially Rs plus j omega L1 parallel to 1 upon j omega. See, if I expand this, I get this terms. And if I evaluate the value of this at square, so I can say magnitude of this can be Rs L1 square omega square 1 minus omega square L1 C1 square. This is a complex quantity, magnitude, real magnitude wise this value will appear. So now you can again check this. If Rs is 0, what will happen? This is 0, this is 0, okay. So what will happen? At omega equal to L1C1 upon L1C1, 1 minus 1 is 0 and impedance goes to infinite. So as long as our basic condition, initially ideal situation, is still available if Rs is 0, okay. At the frequency of omega equal to 1 upon root L1C1, this still gives you infinite impedance. But since Rs is present, so this term is not becoming 0, so there will be finite resistance even at resonant frequency. Typically if you plot, it will be something like this. Can see the denominator parts, so it will start decreasing from its peak value, okay. And if you plot its angle, at omega 1 there is no imaginary quantity, and we say that's why it is echoing. Please remember, expand this, make imaginary quantity 0, then you say at that point phase is 0. On what is the tank principle? That the impedance is matched at that frequency. So the imaginary part as if goes away. So the net phase, this is angle Z, is 0 at resonant frequency. That is what resonant word means. Beyond which, what is the kind of impedance on this side and what is the impedance on this side? This is inductive. The other is capacitor lead and lag, whichever way you look at it. So since only at the resonance, it has much larger Z, which is essentially trying to say there is a Q finite, though it is not infinite, but larger Q is certainly available, which may be, as I say, in ICs, typically is 4, 5, best of times 10, okay. So if we say now that I have this RS is going to be there whether I like or I don't like. So if I want to use this, so I must survive through this Q availability. How much Q? Larger Q is better, but larger is how much? So that we'll see, and we'll take care of that Q in our design so that the system is always still oscillating at. We are not worried very much because the phase goes to zero anyway at resonant frequency, even if Q is not infinite. Okay, that part is this LC circuit, tank circuit always provides. So the first advantage of tank circuit over any RC circuit with active device is there is no question of Barkhausen criteria has to be satisfied. I am independently going anyway, do what you do, okay. And that is the fun part in LC circuits. Okay. This is one example, advantage I told you over RCs. Is that okay? Okay, so in real life, as I said, there will be, but I want to have some better way of representing LC circuit, which is called the parallel representation of this resonant circuit with RS as the series resistance. So I say, okay, if it's LRS series tank, this is therefore sometimes called series tank circuit. Actually, it's also parallel, but all components I want to be in parallel. So I say LP parallel RP parallel CP is equal to this, identically equal to this. So what is the method we have to do it? Calculate impedance of this, calculate impedance of this. Real values on the left must be equal to real values on the right. Imaginary values on the left must be right, imaginary values on the right. So we have two equations we'll get, and those condition relationship between LP, L1, RS all can be figured out. Is that method clear? Find Z for this, find Z for this, equate real part equal, imaginary part equal, and solve this. So RS plus j omega L1 is this, and on this, okay, first equation is, if I do that, RP LPS upon RP LPS is equal to j omega S. If I substitute j omega RP LP is equal to RS plus j omega L, and then please remember I am saying capacitors are identical. They may not be. You can choose different, and then you have a long difficult situation to get. I assume CP is the same as C1. Then I separate them. So whatever is this parallel combination must be equal to this. If I solve this, this is the equation I get. I did lot of equation solving. I actually put this equation into one. I write RS, please look at it the way I am now doing. RS into j omega L into RP into this. If I get it, then that is equal to j omega RP. This is one equation. I say right Z for left, right Z for right, equate the real and imaginary terms, and I get two equations. I think the first part I just showed you. In case you don't want to use it, then you actually write Z for left, Z for right, equate the real and imaginary. So I get LP RS plus L1 RP is RP LP when I equate real values, and RS RP minus omega square L1 LP equal to 0 from the imaginary side. Okay. From here I can write omega square L1 LP is RS RP from here. So LP is RS RP upon omega square L1 LP by this. So I actually, what is the value I want to find? RP, I want to find the equivalent RP corresponding to L and S on the series side. From this equation, I get omega square L1 LP is equal to RS RP. So RP is equal to omega square L1 LP upon RS. So I got one expression for RP in terms of L1, LP and RS. That I will use now in the other equation, substitute there. I replace RPs by the term which I am going to get, and then solve again to get what relationship between LP and L1. I am interested in two terms. I am interested in LP related to L1 and RP related to RS. Is that correct? These are equivalents I want to see. So If I get Rp is omega square L1 Lp by Rs, substitute in the earlier equation 3, which is this, and then you expand that, and at the end of the day, you forget, अच्छा ये बीच का छोड़ दो स्टम्प, मैं डायरेक्टली यहाँ आ गया. I multiply it by Rs from here and I get Lp square Rs square omega square L1 square Lp square Rs Lp Rs L1 omega square L1 Lp square. ये एक ये सब भूल जाओ बीच का. From here I can directly get this, then I realize I need not have done this. From here you come here, or maybe from here you can come here. Okay, ये सब थोड़ा सा trick करने के लिए किया गया है. क्या ट्रिक करना चाहता हूँ मैं कि Q का टर्म कहीं लाना चाहता हूँ. व्हाट इज Q? ओमेगा वन एल वन बाय आर एस इज द Q. इज दैट करेक्ट? ओमेगा वन एल वन बाय आर एस इज द Q. सो इफ आई लुक एट दिस टर्म्स, ओके, ओमेगा स्क्वायर कैंसल्स, दिस कैंसल्स, सो आई ओनली गेट एल पी बाय एल वन, एंड ऑन दिस साइड व्हाट कैंसल्स? R L P square cancels, so 1 plus R S square upon omega square L1 square is L P by L1. थोड़ा सा term ऊपर नीचे किया है मैंने, so that to get that expression what I was looking for. Okay, is that point clear? इसको readjust ऐसा किया है कि इसमें से L square P square से divide कर दिया सबको, and then I get term 1 plus L P square R square upon omega square this. इस term को इसको divide किया है सब जगह. If I do this, I get an expression 1 plus R square omega square L1 square is Lp by L1, but Q is nothing but omega 1 L1 by Rs. So then I can write Lp by L1, that is Lp is equal to N1 times 1 plus 1 upon Q square. Is that correct? Normally, Q is much larger than 3 or 4 or 5. So 1 upon 3 will be, or 1 upon 4 square, or 1 upon 5 square will be 1 by 20, 1 by 9, 1 by 25, larger number. So typically Lp is very close to L1. Larger the Q, you are as much closer. Smaller the Q, you will have to use this expression. Is that clear? If Q is smaller, this term may not be small, and then you have to find the actual value. Normally Qs are larger than 3, at least even on silicon. So one may say 1.1, I can say 1, and I say Lp is L1. I substitute it back here and then I solve for this. Rp is equal to Q square Rs. So Rp is equal to, please remember, Rp is omega square L1 Lp by Rs. I just calculated earlier, where you have seen that expression. Rp is omega square L1 Lp by Rs. I say L1 is equal to Lp. Is that okay? L1 is equal to Lp, so omega square L1 square by Rs, omega square L1 square by Rs square into Rs, which is Q square into Rs. So Rp is Q square times the Rs. Now the way I did it, capacitance I have separated anyway. So Cp is C1. So now I know from the series circuit, I can go to equivalent parallel circuit. Why I am doing it? Because if I see in real life when I make an oscillator, I am going to play this game very nicely. Okay. So I have now Rs in series, now all three are in parallel and they are connected to Q square. Rs is Rp, Cp is C1, and Lp is, if you want exactly this, otherwise Lp is close to L1. Now again, if you add that frequency of omega square is 1 upon Lc, L1 C1 essentially, or Lp Cp, because L and L1 and L L2 are same, so Lps are same. So again say Zh, peak at maximum value occurs at resonant frequency, maybe call it omega 1 or omega whatever way, and the phase, correspondingly is 90 minus 90. So this is the principle of a tank circuit. Okay, I know that when it resonates, it gives you large impedance. Large means this should be much order, higher order, not infinite, but much higher order. And at that point, phases, both L and C phase will cancel, and therefore it will be zero phase. So based on this principle of time circuit, I can make my first cross-coupled oscillators. Is that clear? I now start using this principle. I know now how tank circuit works. I can use now tank circuit with the transistors, two tank circuits, and cross-couple them. Is it okay, figure? Z is same as what I said earlier. So even for parallel circuit they are same, simply because I have made equivalence of that. Okay. So the first cross coupled oscillator, can you now tell me if I want to make a VC out of it, from where I can make a VC out of it?
ISS.
ISS. I can control the ISS from my V control. I can also do something else. Capacitor. So I have two ways I can look into it to convert it into its VCO operation. Okay. You can see here, this is essentially trying to say at a time A ki use karo. Ye ek circuit hai aur ek ye dusra circuit hai. Okay. At one time, let's say it is at fixed value when this is operating, the other time when this is operating, this is at a fixed value. These are two transfer functions, one due to this, one due to this. So what is the net transfer function will be? If H1 omega is transfer function of this, H2 omega is for this, since they are fed back. Please remember this, the way shown here, this output is going to the gate of this, this output is going to the gate of this. Is that point clear to you? Since these are equivalent, like a latch situation, if this voltage changes the currents here, will change here, and therefore change the voltage across this. Is that clear? This is what the cross-coupled word means. So we say at when the close to resonant frequencies or at DC value of that, what is the gain of each stage? When they are in resonant, L and C goes away, only what remains there? RP. RP. So GMRP and GMRP, if they are separate, GM1RP and GM2RP are the gains. So the net gain is product of the two, which is because one is feeding the other. So GM square RP square is the actual gain of this stage. So I can use this cross coupled oscillator, and what is the frequency at which it will operate? As long as, please remember, this is like the latch situation, but why it is not latching now? What is the value I am here looking? RPs are extremely small. RP is the equivalent of a series resistance which is less than ohms, okay? Is that correct? So GM times RP is very, very small compared to GM times R0 in the case of the latch action we said there. A0 went to beyond 2 in no time, okay, and therefore at only at DC when the capacitance has no phase, two inverters could give 360 phase out, and therefore they latch to a 1010 outputs, okay. Whereas here it is identical to that, but now the gains are actually, and where this will happen? Only at frequencies of this interest. So only when they resonate at omega equal to 1 upon root LC, then, or root LPRCP, then only at that time the gain is much smaller, and therefore one can say it will act like a oscillator. Of course, that condition must be that that should be slightly greater, it should be positive, otherwise negative feedback will occur. So it should be positive, but should not be very large positive, and this will help you to oscillate at a frequency of 2 pi, 1 upon 2 pi root LPCP or L1C1, which is same. Is that correct? So this is called cross-coupled LC time circuit based oscillator, which is often used. And as some of you said, I can either change Cp by voltage, and we'll see later, or I can change the ISS value by ISS, because ISS will decide GM1, GM2, and therefore it will decide the point at which oscillations can have that. Okay. Colpitt. There are two names very famous: Colpitt oscillator, and the other is Hartley. Okay. What they did, we'll not solve full of it, but maybe quickly we'll show you. I have one transistor here. I have one Cp across the tank circuit, and I have another capacitance between output to this. And please remember here, what is this transistor is working like? No, no, it's not negative. What is this? Common gate, is that correct? And the input, which is noise, is actually available to at the source of this transistor. Is that clear? Source of this transistor, which is shown here as Colpitt oscillators. Can you think what will be its oscillating frequency roughly? How much is C at this node? These are ground, so this is also ground. These are in series, na? C1, C2 upon C1 plus C2. Is essentially the capacitance which is coming at this node. Is that clear? So L1 into C1 C2 upon LP means LP upon C1 C2 upon C1 plus C2, 1 upon of course that, is the omega square term for this. Usme humne ye abhi CP nahi lagaya. Ab yadi CP lagayenge to kya ho jayega capacitance? CP plus, and that's what you have said, CP plus C1 C2 upon C1 plus C2 will be the new capacitance if I also hold this capacitance here. Is that clear? So essentially it will be decided by what values? LP and the series combination of C1 and C2 will decide the frequency. Iska ek analysis quickly main dikhata hu, aap solve ghar karo ya book mein dekho. Main quickly bata deta hu ki kya kiya hai unhone. You have drawn this figure. Equal, I am right now not using CP, but later I'll add. Please remember CP is only paralleling there, so I'll add additional capacitance if I need that. The reason why I removed this CP from here, because the actual Colpitt oscillator did not have a CP there, that's why actually it was not used. We can add that to C equivalent of our network, but since in actual Colpitt there was no CP here. The only thing is there was no transistor then, it was a vacuum triode which was used in those cases. Okay. The first Colpitt oscillator was used with vacuum device. Kitna bada hota hai triode malum hai? At least 4 to 5 inches long, at least 2 inches in dia, quartz ka rehta hai, uske andar ek filament rehta hai, ek grid rehta hai, ek plate rehta hai. Thoda incandescent lamp sir ka dikhta hai. Okay. Or rather candescent lamp. Okay. Iska equivalent circuit hai. Aap bana lo. Main abhi aapko explain nahi karunga. We have done this equivalence n times. This is a common gate amplifier. So thoda sa soch laga lo. Okay. Aisa hi kyun kiya, aisa mat karo. Ye IN jo hai, ye noise voltage hai. Because oscillations cannot start unless there is some signal comes. So we assume IN is the noise voltage. And please remember this is the source end of the transistor. So source ke upar maine current source laga diya. Pehle transistor ka VGS jo hai. Please remember the gate is grounded. In common gate, gates are grounded. VB hai na, fixed value hai wahan par. So that is grounded. And between source and the gate, let's say the potential is V1. Which gives me an output current of GMV1, then there is a capacitance C1 and C2, so part of the current goes through C2, there is also current in C1, then this is your LPRP and this is your output voltage. So how much current actually, how many at a given node at this, how much current you can see? This current, this current, this current, and this current. Is that clear? Output per current sum kiya ja sakta hai. Okay. So we'll do that. So V1 jo hai, if I want to find this voltage, this is ground. So I am trying to find this voltage. So IN, ye ground hai idhar se. IN minus this current, okay. Minus because opposite sign, ye minus pa sign hai. So upar ja raha hai, niche plus nahi hai. So IN minus Vout by LPS minus Vout by RP into this capacitance. Because this is current into 1 upon C1S is V1. Drop across C1 is V1 minus, of course, because it is the opposite polarity there. So I can calculate this voltage V1. So GM times V1 is known to me. Is that clear? I want to calculate current in this arm. How much is that? This is Vout minus of minus V1 into C2S is the current in this GV, okay, or Vout plus V1 into C2S. So IC2 is, and then I substitute V1 from this here, so I get Vout minus IN minus Vout by this into C2S. So I got IC2 as the current in this arm. I know GM V1 because GM times this current is also known to me. I know this current. I know this current. So sum total current should be 0 at node. Okay. So is that okay? Char current 8 node per 0. Sum of them are 0. So I calculate this current. I calculate this current. I know this current. I know this current. Add 4 currents and equate them to 0. Is that written down? So to say GM V1 plus IC2 Vout by LPS Vout by RP is 0, or if you sub substitute K, you dikhaya maine, so Vout by IN, itna bada expression aata hai. Okay. Wo maine rough mein calculate kiya tha, fir finally is pe likh diya maine. Okay. What is the condition of oscillation? We say the impedance should tend to infinite, okay. So Vout by IN should tend to infinite if oscillation to occur at frequency of omega r, which is called resonant frequency. So isko yadi aap isko zero karenge denominator ko, to aapko dikhega omega square r is 1 upon LP times C1 C2 upon C1 plus C. Wo aapko pehle bola maine. Okay. Dekh ke dekh sakte ho kitna hai. And the second part, from the this GMRP, real and imaginary part. So GMRP is C1 C2 upon 1 plus C2 by C1 square. If I use C2 by C1 1, that is C1 same as this, kitna hoga GMRP? 4. So at least the minimum DC gain you expect is 4, slightly more because it should sustain it, okay. And if you know C1 C2 here, this is C1 square upon 2 C1. So just LP C1 by 2 is the frequency available for you at the resonance for this. And abhi maine pehle hi bola, yadi aap colpit ko purane tank circuit mein hi dalna chahte hain, to ek CP capacitance uske isme add parallel hai, to add ho jata hai. So I can calculate the resonant frequency of a colpit oscillator by deciding, and GM is decided by what? The bias current I will put. RP of course is not in my hand, it is inductance, whatever Q I have, I will decide on that. Q square RS is RP. Okay. Okay. So ye bhi ek oscillator hai, colpit. Ab capacitor ke jagah aur inductance ke jagah aap ulta kariye. Wahan capacitor lagiye aur yahan par inductance lagayenge. तो ये का यही सर्किट क्या कहलाएगा? हार्टले ऑसिलेटर. जहां सी है वहां एल करिए, जहां एल है वहां सी कर दीजिए. दैट विल बिकम हार्टले ऑसिलेटर. प्लीज रिमेंबर, हार्टले केम लेटर. दो इन मेनी ओल्ड बुक दे ऑलवेज स्टार्ट विद हार्टले ऑसिलेटर एंड दे शो कोलपिट लेटर, बट आई मे टेल यू अगेन, कोलपिट ऑसिलेटर वाज मेड फर्स्ट एंड हार्टले वाज अ मॉडिफिकेशन. डू यू नो व्हाट काइंड ऑफ कैपेसिटेंसेस वी यूज्ड टू यूज इन दोस केसेस? वेरिएबल कैपेसिटेंस. We have no diodes as such with variable. What do kind of capacitors we used? Anyone has seen? You must have seen it. ऐसी एक मेटालिक प्लेट रहती है, दूसरी मेटालिक प्लेट उसमें ऐसी बाहर अंदर जा, इसको बोलते हैं गैंग कंडेंसर. तो प्लेट्स जो हैं दो इसमें घूमती हैं, अंदर गई तो डिस्टेंस कम हो जाता है, बाहर आई तो डिस्टेंस बढ़ जाता है. तो यू चेंज द कैपेसिटेंस बाय नॉब, तो पूरी की पूरी आठ प्लेट्स दूसरे नौ प्लेट्स के अंदर चली जाती हैं, बाहर निकालो तो चेंज हो जाता है, उसको बोलते हैं गैंग कंडेंसर. सो आपके एक्चुअली रेडियो रिसीवर जो रहते थे, जो आप कहते हैं ना ट्यूनर, तो वो एक्चुअली गैंग कंडेंसर का ट्यूनर था. उसको घुमाओगे तो वो प्लेट अंदर या बाहर आती है. दैट इज हाउ यूज टू ट्यून दी डिफरेंट बैंड्स. टाइम्स हैव चेंज्ड. ओके, सो हियर इज द अनदर काइंड ऑफ ओसिलेटर. दिस इज ओनली फन पार्ट इन दैट. देयर आर अदर काइंड्स ऑफ ओसिलेटर्स. बिफोर वी क्विट फॉर द डे, दिस मे बी द लास्ट. दिस इज वेरी इंटरेस्टिंग. Someone earlier in between said that, no, okay, though now I'll show you that. A typical noise source is shown here, is fed to a tank circuit, a CPR, PLP. Because if you give noise, it will die down after some time, because RP will dissipate out. Ek baar to karega, par wo baad mein die kar dega. Okay. Ab humne kaha yaar, isko ideal tank kaise banaye? Let's say if this RP ke shunt mein एक माइनस आरपी लगा दिया मैंने, देन इट विल एक्ट लाइक ए आइडियल टैंक सर्किट एंड देन इट शुड ऑसिलेट इवन विद द स्मॉल नॉइज सिग्नल, इट शुड स्टार्ट ऑसिलेटिंग. सो द गेम वाज दैट यू हैव अ टैंक सर्किट एंड यू कनेक्ट इट विथ ए सम एक्टिव सर्किट सच दैट द इनपुट ऑफ दैट इज इक्विवेलेंट ऑफ माइनस आरपी. सो इट्स कॉल्ड नेगेटिव इंपेडेंस कन्वर्टर और जनरेटर. If I can create minus RP out of this active circuit, then I will be able to cancel this RP, RP and minus RP, and therefore we may say that I have an ideal tank circuit, it will oscillate. And it doesn't require then any other this, only of course you have an active device, but in fact actually you are using only one time, one start it starts. However, this circuit should maintain minus RP all that time. Okay. So you need that. You know, that it's not something like laga nikal diya. Okay. Is that point clear? One simple negative impedance generator circuit is shown here now. Okay. And based on this, we will show you an oscillator. This is also, as I say, GM oscillator, as it is called, transconductance oscillator. Is figure clear? RP cancelled by minus RP. इस minus RP की जगह मैंने एक active circuit लगाया है कि जो उसका input impedance is minus RP. And the fun part there is it is independent of frequency. ऐसा नहीं कि resonant frequency पे minus RP, वो हमेशा ही minus RP है. Okay. That is why it will, once you provide that, it will always oscillate. There is nothing to worry about. Is that okay? ये देखिए साहब, ये है, this is negative impedance generator. I have two transistor M1, M2. This is a common gate circuit. This is common base, common source circuit. And यहाँ पर इसका input terminal है. Okay. दूसरा ground ही of course. This is biased through a IB1. This is biased through IB2 or call it IB1 also. It is immaterial. It is biased same or different. If it is different, then GMs are different. Please remember, if you bias it differently, their GMs are different. But if you assume same, then GMs will be same. Ab iska equivalent. What is the equivalent of this? How do I calculate impedance? I apply a voltage Vx at that terminal and find the current there. So Vx by Ix is the R there. Or Z there. Okay. So I have a source Vx at this terminal. Please remember where I am calculating Rin. Is that okay? So this Vx is supplied by me, and I am monitoring this current Ix at this node. Is input mein kitna current ja raha hai? AC part. So if you look at it, since it is going to, this is M1 and this is M2. From Vx, ये इसका ड्रेन है M2 का, तो ये M2 का ड्रेन है. M2 में क्या करंट फ्लो होगा? GM to V2. What is V2? We'll see, but GM to V2. ये ड्रेन है इसका,
ये इसका
M1 का गेट भी है,
तो ये M1
का गेट है. ओके, आई रिपीट, दिस इज D2 एंड दिस इज G1. ओके, सो नाउ
फ्रॉम G1 देयर
मस्ट बी सम VGS V1 विच इज क्रिएटिंग करंट इन M1 विच इज GM V1, बट दिस इज गोइंग टू VDD फॉर AC इट इज ग्राउंड. सो AC इट इज ग्राउंड, सो दिस इज द ड्रेन ऑफ M1. ओके,
and this is the source of M1.
From source of M1 to G1 must be some potential V1 which is causing this current to flow. Okay, but this source is connected to the source of,
so dono ke source same hai.
Aur yahan se yahan par kuch voltage hona chahiye VGS, because otherwise there is no M2 conduction, so there should be a potential V2, and this is ground. So this is ground. Is that equivalent clear to you, all of you? I start with this, go supply source of Vx, and I want to monitor Ix. Okay.
The D2 of this,
there is a GM2 V2, and since this is same as G1, I have a separate voltage which is VGS for M1. So that gives me V1, which gives me a current source of GM V1 in this, but the other end is grounded, so that is grounded, and the source of this and source of these are connected, so source of these and source of these are connected. Okay, now we see, if I see Ix, this is the current Ix, but if you see opposite of this, this is going to the ground this side, which essentially means Ix is also equal to minus GM1 V1. But what is Vx? You can see from here, this is Vx and this is V1. So V1 minus V2 is nothing but Vx. फिर से देख करो, ये Vx है ग्राउंड के साथ है, और V1 V2, सो V1 यहाँ से यहाँ, ये यहाँ, और इसमें से ये सब्सट्रैक्ट हुआ, दैट इज द Vx. सो Vx इज V1 माइनस V2, बट Ix इज GM2 V2 माइनस और इक्वल टू माइनस GM1.
यहाँ से
V1 V2 वहाँ सब्सटीट्यूट कर दिया मैंने, सो Vx इज इक्वल टू Ix अपॉन माइनस GM1 माइनस Ix अपॉन GM2. लेट अस से IVs आर सेम, सो यू मे से 1 अपॉन GM1 प्लस 1 सेम एज 2 बाय GM, सो माइनस 2 बाय GM. सो इनपुट सीन फ्रॉम दिस टर्मिनल इज माइनस 2 बाय GM, तो निगेटिव इम्पिडेंस मिल गया आपको. नाउ एडजस्ट दिस GM वैल्यू बाय व्हाट, Ix करंट और इवन साइजेस टू सम एक्सटेंट, यू कैन एडजस्ट W/L एज वेल, एंड गेट द वैल्यू ऑफ Rn विच इज इक्वल टू Rp. ओके, एंड एज यू ट्यून इट यू विल एक्चुअली गेट ओसिलेशंस, सस्टेन ओसिलेशंस. This is very interesting, and the actual use of this negative impedance terminal last oscillator for this side, is that okay? Is that ma'am clear? So trivial it looks, but very powerful negative impedance generator. Do you know what? A similar negative impedance generator can be used, generation has been tried in op-amps or diff-amps. What is it called? सेकंड में पढ़ाया था यार तुम, नहीं तुम लोगों को नहीं, क्या पढ़ा, नाम दिया था मैंने गायरेटर. ए निगेटिव इम्पिडेंस जनरेटर विथ ओपैम्स इज कॉल्ड गायरेटर. सो गायरेटर बहुत पॉपुलर सर्किट है. इक्विवेलेंट गायरेटर इज शोन हियर विथ 2 ट्रांजिस्टर्स कनेक्टेड इन दिस फैशन, यू कैन क्रिएट निगेटिव इम्पिडेंस एंड GM डिसाइड्स द वैल्यू फॉर योर Rp यू आर चूजिंग एट टाइम दिस. प्लीज रिमेंबर Rp's आर वेरी स्मॉल, Rp's are very small, 10 Rs, 20 Rs, Rs is ohms, less than a ohm. Now this means GM should be very high, okay? And this higher GM means power. So to create this, you will pump power. Okay. फॉर अ सर्किट पर्सन फर्स्ट थिंग पावर क्या गया, तो अभी फ्रीक्वेंसी ढूंढ रहे थे, इधर पावर पे आ गए। इसका एक इक्वलेंट सस्टेनेबल सर्किट जो वो ये है,
इसको बोलते हैं
क्रॉस कपल ऑसिलेटर। बट अभी क्या, नहीं नहीं अभी इसको क्या कर सकते हैं कि यू कैन सी फ्रॉम हियर दिस एंड दिस टू ट्रांजिस्टर्स आर सो कनेक्टेड, दे एक्चुअली आर प्रोवाइडिंग नेगेटिव इम्पीडेंस एट दिस टू टर्मिनल्स वन बाय वन। थिंक ऑफ इट, सो एट जस्ट जीएम ऑफ हियर यू विल गेट आरपी एंड माइनस आरपी अक्रॉस दिस एंड दे विल बी सस्टेन्ड ऑसिलेशंस फ्रॉम दिस जनरेटर्स। This is essentially negative impedance based LC oscillators. Is that clear? That's very, there are no this essentially requirements. These RPs are cancelled. Please look at it. इसको एक बार VB रखिए, दूसरे बार इसको VB रखिए, और वो दोनों सर्किट आपस में एक जैसे ही हैं. Okay. All that is एक बार ISS एक में से जा रहा है, दूसरे बार ISS इधर से जा रहा है. But essentially ISS by 2 is provided to each of them and therefore it will act like a same circuit which I showed. At this node it is minus RP for this, at this it is minus RP for this, and you can now say this is sustainable oscillator which is used. This is negative GM oscillators. Is that clear? Negative GM oscillators. Okay, and these are also very popular. Ab iska ek aur modified version फ्राइडे को दिखा देते हैं, उसमें हम निगेटिव न किया भी तो भी चलेगा, सीपी को ही एडजस्ट कर देते हैं, एंड दैट विल बी द वन विच वीसीओ वी आर गोइंग टू ऑफन यूज इन रियल लाइफ सर्किट्स। इज दैट ओके? द प्रॉब्लम आई सेड इन दिस मॉर्निंग दैट देयर आर इश्यूज ऑफ ड्रिफ्ट्स अवेलेबल इररिस्पेक्टिव टू व्हाट, ओके, एंड यू वांट टू रिटेन दैट चेंज इन फ्रीक्वेंसी और चेंज इन टाइम विच इज कॉल्ड जिटर एंड phase noise. So how to get rid of them, and the circuit we use is PLL. PLL will not be part of this exam course, but I will tell you what is PLL because that's something you all should know, because I don't know your mixed signal circuit people, if at all you take that course, whether they believe that is actually PLL is a pseudo. So it can be a mixed signal or it can be analog, whichever you look at it. Like phase detectors are essentially digital parts. एक्सआर है वहां पर, तो एक्सआर को एनालॉग बोलना कि डिजिटल पता नहीं ना, इसलिए अभी कंफ्यूजन है, बट आई शो यू एसेंशियली पीएलएल, मे बी इफ टाइम परमिट आई ऑल्सो शो यू वेरी इंटरेस्ट व्हाट इज द स्विच सर्किट सर, ओके, विच इज अगेन मिक्स सिग्नल शुड टॉक अबाउट। सो सी यू टिल फ्राइडे।